Good evening again. It's good to be here, and I appreciate each one of you for taking the time to join us tonight. I'm going to ask you a question, and you might know the answer. What does Arnold Schwarzenegger, Madonna, not the lady in the manger, Garry Kasparov, Steve Martin, and Albert Einstein all have in common?
Same birthday.
No. They weren't all actors. Einstein surely wasn't. What's that?
They were famous.
Some more than less.
Say the names again.
Yes, Arnold Schwarzenegger, Madonna, Garry Kasparov, Stephen Martin, and Albert Einstein.
Atheists?
No, they all had either genius or near genius IQs. They're all extremely intelligent people. Now, I want you to think about something for a minute. We think about what we know. We think about what we know. And sometimes we equate in a direct proportional sense what we know with our salvation or our experience. And that may not necessarily be so. A.T. Jones, speaking through the Review and Herald in 1899, made this statement. He said, "In all points of our faith, we do differ with other people." Let me just pause there. Do you think A.T. Jones had a handle on the different aspects of Adventism? You know, people say, "What makes you different?" Well, we go to church on Saturday. We don't eat meat, or maybe we don't eat pork at least. And a few other things like that. And that's what we say makes us different. But Jones goes so far as to say, this faith of ours, if you start to dissect it and you start to look at it, we differ with other people in all points of our faith. He says, in straight up and down faith in Jesus Christ, we differ, for we have a deeper faith than they. If we haven't, what good is there in our being Seventh-day Adventists? And so, if our faith doesn't change us, help to bring us to that place, we get the victory over those things. See? Then we need to sort of examine things. And you know what? I've found this to be true many times. People, they start to examine things, but then they find fault with the faith and not with themselves. Because the faith is true, the faith is right. But sometimes we let the faith down. But if we have the true faith as it is in Jesus, friends, it will not fail us. We might ask, what is our spiritual IQ? There are scholars, what we call scholars in Roman Catholicism, in forms of Protestantism, even Buddhists who go to school and become PhDs in their philosophy and religion, and oh, they have high IQs, and they're scholarly, you know. And we might even take it a step further and say, you know, what is our religious IQ? You know, what is my IQ as an Adventist? Because we know, friends, we know that given a Bible, just a Bible, we can whip anybody up and down the street in a debate. We know that. Because we have that spiritual IQ. But you know what? If we're not living differently than they live, if we're not living better than they live, as Jones says, then what good is there in our being Seventh-day Adventists? If it's just simply having head knowledge alone, and that is especially true concerning the Final Atonement, if we only understand the Final Atonement from some kind of a chart or some kind of memorized protocol of procedures or something, then we're not stacking up where we need to be. Not at all. Now, the typical Yom Kippur. Remember what Yom Kippur was? What does it mean?
Day of Atonement.
Day of what?
Atonement.
Atonement. Day of Atonement. We call it the Day of Atonement. It means Day of Atonement. We said that one of the things that was very important that we as a people study is called the investigative judgment. Do you remember that? And about three nights or four nights ago, we went through some of the history and the development of the understanding of the doctrine of the investigative judgment in Adventism. But we know that there's more. We know that there's something called the cleansing of the sanctuary that takes a little step beyond just simply the investigative judgment. But we also know that there's more. That all of this together makes up something we call the Day of Atonement or the Final Atonement. But there's some points that we've not looked at or not yet fully considered in relationship to how all this works yet. For instance, we did hear a little bit yesterday about the scapegoat. And you notice where I put the scapegoat here. Do you see where I put the scapegoat? Because there's aspects of this scapegoat that are involved in the cleansing of the sanctuary that are also but included in the overall bigger view of what we call this Day of Atonement. And then there's another part, and we hinted at this yesterday. It's this part on the bottom. The wicked are destroyed. That's part of this larger concept that we call the Day of Atonement, or the Final Atonement. For instance, and it was brought up, I believe, this morning by one of our speakers, in Leviticus chapter 23 and verse 29. You remember that? Which one of you two guys brought that up? You read it. Okay, let's go back and read it again. Leviticus 23:29. And I know someone else mentioned something about this the other day, and I would like to just say something complimentary about what was said the other day. Leviticus 23:29. It says, of course, you know, we read that it was necessary to have affliction of soul on this day. And it says, "For whatsoever soul it be that shall not be afflicted in that same day, he shall be cut off from among his people." Do you see that? And someone made the statement to the effect of that there was a separation. They would be separated from the camp. But may I ask you to turn with me, please, to Daniel chapter 9 and verse 26. Daniel 9:26. This is a prophecy concerning the Messiah. And after 62 weeks, shall Messiah be what?
Cut off.
He was just separated from the people. Is that what it means? To cut off meant that he was to be killed. This Hebrew word means to be destroyed, to be killed. And in fact, it's the same Hebrew word translated in Leviticus 23, verse 29. They're both in the Niphil form in the Hebrew. They carry the same meaning. In other words, friends, people who did not become involved in the Day of Atonement, they were to be slain.
Right.
It just wasn't that they were to be put out of the camp. They were to be slain. And when does that happen in the antitype? When does it happen in the antitype? The wicked, the final annihilation of the wicked happens at the end of the 1,000 years. It certainly does. And so, in one sense, we could say the atonement occurs, according to Romans 14:11. When Satan bows down and acknowledges that Christ is Lord and King of Kings. I was reading it. In fact, if you want the exact pages in Great Controversy, I believe it's page 688, paragraph 2, and page 670, paragraph 2. I was reading it this afternoon while I was waiting on my wrist. And there she speaks about this. In fact, you should read that whole section. You think about what we're talking about in this Day of Atonement and the final eradication of sin. Because this oneness can only happen fully and totally when sin is gone. And so in one sense, this agreement by Satan, because there it says, just prior to that, that that Satan and his host stand before the bar of God and sentence is pronounced upon them. Sentence is pronounced upon him. And this great panorama in the sky occurs. And they see the plan of salvation. And she speaks there about Nero, for instance. And how he sees inside the city some of those very Christians that he delighted in torturing to death. And he sees them in joy now. And here is Satan. And he finally bows down. He acknowledges the justice in God's sentence. But you know what he does after that? He has a change of heart. He says, well, I'm still going to try to take the city. Can't get anyone to agree with him this time, but he tries to go back and take the city. But then you have the final finishing of the atonement. Because sin will be totally eradicated. Fire comes down from heaven, our God, and devours or consumes them. And that will be the finishing of this final atonement work. Now, A.T. Jones, I believe it's true that when you look at our faith, really our faith is different in every respect. But there are points of commonality. There are other people who believe in the second coming of Christ, similar to the way we do, but we have nuances, it's true. And we have nuances in almost everything. But the one thing that really, really makes us unique is the sanctuary doctrine. We are told the Scripture, which above all others had been both the foundation and the central pillar of the Advent faith, was the declaration in the 2,300 days, then shall the sanctuary be cleansed. And that's from Great Controversy, page 409. And we discussed a little bit, as I mentioned the other night, the growth of the development of some of this teaching among us as a church. Now, tell me what book, chapter, and verse that I find the term investigative judgment in the Bible.
It's not there.
Oh, wait a minute. It's not there. Does that mean it's not a biblical teaching?
No.
The term investigative judgment is a coined term to represent something. But you know, there are other statements in theology that we use. For instance, the word incarnation. What does the word incarnation mean?
Made in the flesh.
In the flesh. It's from Latin. It means in the flesh. And we believe Jesus, the Word, became flesh. We believe this concept that we call the incarnation to be a biblical doctrine, even if the term incarnation is never used in the Bible. And we could say the same thing for the term millennium. Okay. However, I think it is interesting to note that the Spirit of Prophecy does talk about the term millennium. The Spirit of Prophecy talks about the term incarnation. And the Spirit of Prophecy talks about the term investigative judgment several times, eight in the book Great Controversy alone. And so it was a term that was well used and understood by Ellen White and her contemporaries in the Advent movement. And she said about this particular doctrine that the subject of the sanctuary, and I don't think this is the first time you've had this read to you this week, is it? The subject of the sanctuary and the investigative judgment should be clearly understood by the people of God. You know, I appreciate something that Brother Elvis did during the communion service. He was sort of doing a walk through the sanctuary. Remember that? But you can't do that if you don't understand it. You can't do that if you don't know it. So it says, the subject of the sanctuary and the investigative judgment should be clearly understood by the people of God. All need a knowledge for themselves of the position and work of their great high priest. Otherwise, it will be impossible for them to exercise the faith which it is essential at this time, or to occupy the position which God designs them to fill. The term investigative judgment and the concept that God would have an open investigation of all the records of the books in heaven, it has never settled well with evangelical Christians. And Adventists, in an attempt to make friends and to influence people, they changed our teachings. They started to use different terminology. We use the term pre-Advent judgment. All Adventists believe that this investigative judgment, as we call it here tonight, is before the coming of Jesus. And so the term pre-Advent judgment is used because it's a kinder and gentler doctrine. What is there about this doctrine, though, that is not so pleasing to the evangelicals? Why is it that they don't want to accept this concept? It's not just simply because they're going to be judged, but because of things that it implies and that are clearly taught in it. Because connected with the concept of the investigative judgment is this idea of a final atonement, and also, friends, the vindication of the character of God. And this, I believe, is the uniqueness of Adventism. Think about the history of Christianity. For 1,800 years, before there was a Seventh-day Adventist, or I should say before there was a formal Seventh-day Adventist, Adam was the first Seventh-day Adventist. That's a long time ago. You know Adam was the Seventh-day Adventist, don't you? He kept the seventh-day Sabbath. He was looking forward to the coming of Jesus. But this concept of forgiveness You sin and you ask for forgiveness. You sin and you ask for forgiveness. You sin and you ask for forgiveness. This was basic Christianity among all apostate Christianity for almost 2 millennia. No evangelical church today accepts or teaches an investigative judgment or the cleansing of the heavenly sanctuary. And we've looked at some of these texts this week. I shouldn't probably have to say too many of them. But we know that the Bible says that the sanctuary that was on earth, of which also the temples were patterned after, Solomon's temple, Zerubbabel's temple, Herod's temple, that was built from a pattern of something that already existed in heaven. And the reason that God wanted to have this sanctuary is because He said that I may, what? Dwell among them. He wanted to dwell among us. Now I want you to notice something that Paul says in Hebrews chapter 9 in speaking about the reality. Hebrews chapter 9. So let's go to Hebrews 9. Let me go back to verse 22. He says, "And almost all things are by the law purged with blood. Without shedding of blood, there is no remission." Verse 23. "It was therefore necessary that the patterns of things in the heavens should be purified with these." The patterns. These sanctuaries that Aaron ministered in, and Eleazar, okay, and these other men later, he said these things were patterns, and they were all cleansed or purged, he says, almost all things by blood. He says it was therefore necessary that the patterns of these things in the heavens should be purified with these, but the heavenly things themselves with better sacrifices than these. For Christ has not entered into the holy places made with hands, which are a figure of the true, but into heaven itself, now to appear in the presence of God for us. Paul is saying that there's a reality, that all of this comes down to a reality, and it culminates in this thing we call the Day of Atonement. Now, while the earthly sanctuary was to be cleansed with the blood of bulls and goats, the heavenly sanctuary was to be cleansed with the precious blood of Jesus Christ. Each day of the year, the record of sin was taken into the earthly sanctuary, where it polluted the sanctuary, until the Day of Atonement, when all the confessed sins of the people were to be removed and cleansed forever. Sadly, the reality never came in the earthly sanctuary. And in fact, it could never come. Because as Paul says in Hebrews chapter 10 and verse 4, "For it is not possible that the blood of bulls and of goats should take away sin." Because friends, the blood of bulls and goats isn't equal to the law of God. Only one whose blood was equal to the law of God, and the life is in the blood. The blood represents the death. Only that person, only that individual, and there's only one individual in the universe that could meet that requirement. And who was that?
Jesus
Christ. Jesus Christ. The apostle sums up the main focus of the various sanctuary services by making reference to the daily offering and to the once a year Day of Atonement offering. We read that the other night in Hebrews chapter 9, verses 6 and 7. Paul there speaks about two main services. And those services are outlined or delineated in Leviticus chapter 4 and Leviticus chapter 16. And we looked at some of the highlights of those the other night. And if you weren't here, get the tape. You want to see it. But remember in Leviticus 4:31, the result for the common person in the sin offering was just spelled out this plain: the priest shall make an atonement for him, and it shall be forgiven him. Leviticus 4:31. It says that there's an atonement of forgiveness there. But in Leviticus chapter 16 and verse 30, he says that this was to cleanse you, that you may be clean from all your sins before the Lord. Now, in both cases, now, we're trying to do more than just increase our spiritual IQ tonight, right? We're trying to find out what really this means to us, not just in intellectual knowledge, but how this is going to affect us in our lives, right? In both cases, there was an atonement made for the sinner. One atonement provided forgiveness and the other cleansing. And we might say, well, what's the difference? What's the difference? Why is it important? Why do we have to fool with all this? Because no one else teaches it. We could get by and be a lot better off without teaching this in our relationships with other churches. But may I remind you of something that Jesus said in Matthew chapter 4, I believe it's in verse 4. He's quoting from the Old Testament. He said, "Man shall not live by bread alone, but by every word that proceedeth from the mouth of God." And so, friends, there's not a scripture from Genesis to Revelation that we can ignore.
Right.
There's nothing in the scripture that can be taken lightly. Everything has its place, and its place is not of minor value. And Paul, instead of rewriting the book of Leviticus again, he just sums it up in Hebrews, and he's tying it in. Now that we don't have a priest who is from the line of Aaron anymore, we have a priest after the order of Melchizedek. And you remember what that word Melchizedek, or the name Melchizedek, meant? We told you the other night. It meant the king of what? Of righteousness, the one who's vindicating everything, and forgiveness, and everything's involved in that. In that Hebrew word, tzedakah. Remember tzedakah? We talked about that the other night. But since the issue is important, the next thing we must determine is, why is it important? And I think we have a very enlightening statement from Ellen White. It was published in the Review and Herald of June 4, 1895. She says, "The righteousness by which we are justified is imputed. The righteousness by which we are sanctified is imparted. The first is our title to heaven. The second is our fitness for heaven."
Amen.
Ellen White's making some distinctions here. And at first we see these words and we might think, well, what's the difference? We see a couple words, for instance, justified and sanctified. We see imputed. We see imparted. We see title. And we see fitness. Ellen White's using some parallel structure here as she's writing. I think most of us have an idea what justification is, don't we? You know, if you come to Jesus, you're forgiven, you can be just as if you never sinned in His eyes. Sanctification, you're set apart, you're living holy now. Imputed and imparted. Now, in the Bible, you'll see the word imputed. You never see the word imparted. Imparted is like a theological word that's sort of been added, but it has a nuance of meaning. In fact, in many ways, just like the word imputed is used in places in the Bible. When we talk about the imputed righteousness of Jesus, when you hear someone, a preacher or a theologian or whoever they are, or you read in Ellen White's writings because it's here, that simply means that this is the righteousness that God gives you as a free gift. You just get it right now and it's yours. It's just that simple. It's like when He gives you forgiveness. Forgiveness is not a process, is it? It's something that happens. You come to Jesus just as you are with a sincere heart, and He forgives you. Imparted righteousness is righteousness you receive in parts. A little part here, a little more part here. It's a progressive, growing state of your position, relationship with God. Now, Ellen White says that being justified and having this imputed righteousness is our title to heaven. It's like you got the invitation. But Jesus also told us something in a parable. And there was a man who made a great feast for his son. He was going to have a wedding. And to get in the wedding, you had to have something called a wedding garment. Now, all these people had been invited, hadn't they? They had a title to go in. They had like a card, the invitation card, we call it. But you had to have a fitness to walk in. You had to have a robe of righteousness to walk in that keeps you fit. And that's this fitness for heaven. We have to have a fitness for heaven too. Now, I think back when my little daughter was just about Jonathan's age. And we were going to go somewhere one day. And she was in a nice little dressy dress, if you know what I mean. But Mom and Dad were a little slower getting ready than she was. She wanted to go out and play a little bit first. Okay, but don't you get dirty. And just a little bit later, here she is at the door just crying. Because she'd gotten her dress dirty. And she was so sorry. "Mommy, I'm so sorry. I'm so sorry." You know, she was forgiven. Of course she was forgiven. But you know what we had to do, Sandy? We had to take the dress off and clean it. She was still dirty. She was forgiven, but she wasn't clean. And that's the way we are sometimes, friends. And that's a poor illustration in some respects, but it's the best I can come up with right now. But think about this. In our lives, the Lord can forgive us. But maybe I'm an alcoholic and I still want to go back to that bottle. And He's got to cure me of wanting to go back to that bottle or the cigar or whatever it is, right? And He wants to do that for us. Now, Brother Andy was telling us the other day that he used to use smokeless tobacco. And he said after he became a Christian, even while he was in a meeting to learn how to teach others about Jesus, he said he had the strongest urge to want to use tobacco he'd ever had in his life. The Lord doesn't always take away our cravings. He doesn't always take away the temptations or desire. But the one thing he always does, through this imparted, sanctified righteousness of Jesus, he gives us the power to overcome and to obey his word in every single case. Amen. And if he doesn't, then we have a problem. Yep. Now, I'd like to say as Adventists, we have a problem. We're better Jews than the Jews. Do you know what I mean by that? Mm-hmm. We're better than Jesus. We want a good deal, don't we? Mm-hmm. We want a good deal. And we deserve a good deal, we think. No. We think that. You know. And so we go to the dealership, and the guy says, I want $6,000 for the car. And we say, well, but really, you know, you don't want that. Let's talk about this. Let's get a discount. I wonder how much I can get a discount on. Right? We do this. Mac doesn't. Good for you, Mac. But that's what we do, friends, when it comes to salvation and how much we can live. Lord, what kind of a discount do I get on sin? What kind of a discount do I get? And you know what Jesus says in thundering but yet sweet tones back to us? He says, you don't get any discount. There's no discount at all. My son has paid the full price already. His precious blood was shed so that you, as you have Christ living in you, right? Colossians 1:27. As you have Christ living in you, then you can overcome that. And this is what makes this whole concept not so sweet to most of the evangelical Christian world, because they don't want to overcome sin, and they don't want you to have to overcome sin. And even in Adventism now, this is taught and accepted as the norm. Ellen White says this, the blood of Christ, why it was to release the repentant sinner from the condemnation of the law, was not to cancel the sin. It would stand on record in the sanctuary until the final atonement. Amen. There is a final atonement. Until the final atonement. So in the type, the blood of the sin offering removed the sin from the penitent, but it rested in the sanctuary until the day of atonement. Now, there's an imperative point that we should make, and that is that the work of Calvary is totally complete in what it was designed to do. The efficacy of the cross provides for both the daily and the yearly service. That's right. And without the blood of Christ, friends, we are lost. Now, actually, I'm going to go to a slide in a minute. You don't have that slide, so you don't have to worry about it, but I added this at the end. This is probably the first time you've ever seen me preach at Camping and I didn't have a tie on. And there's two reasons for that. Number one, my hand's not really good for tying ties tonight. But secondly, I want you to see my shirt because it's the nicest shirt I have. I didn't mean it that way. This shirt used to belong to this young man. His mother is Valentina in Belarus. And he was one of President Yeltsin's bodyguards. And he was killed in an assassination attempt against President Yeltsin when he was president of Russia. And his mother held some of his clothing, including a suit of his, for years. She wanted a believer to have them, that maybe they would fit. And she loves me. She's a dear sweetheart. And so she gave me this shirt. And every time I wear this shirt, I realize that this man was not wearing this shirt when he was defending the president, because it doesn't have any bullet holes or blood stain in it. But it's a dear shirt to me, and I only wear it very, very seldom on special occasions. But it reminds me of the blood of Jesus, because someone's blood was shed, and that's why I had this shirt. And someone's blood was shed, and that's why we have salvation tonight. And the cross, as someone one time said, it is the straw that stirs the drink. It's what brings our hearts to Jesus, and we don't need to diminish it in any way. But we need to realize, friends, that the plan of salvation wasn't finished at the cross. In 1 Corinthians chapter 15, if you could turn there with me. I'm going to start reading verse 14 for a little context. Paul says, and if Christ be not risen, then is our preaching vain, and your faith is also vain. If Christ be not what?
Risen.
You mean if there's no resurrection, my faith is vain? You mean something about the atonement couldn't have been completed at Calvary because there's a resurrection that's necessary?
Amen.
Is that what Paul's saying?
Amen.
Am I being fair with the text?
Yes.
Verse 15, yea, and we are found false witnesses of God, because we have testified that He raised up Christ, whom He raised not up, if so be that the dead rise not. Verse 16, for if the dead rise not, then is not Christ raised. And if Christ be not raised, your faith is vain. Ye are yet in your what?
Sins.
Sins, friends. You can't get out of sin without the resurrection of Jesus. But Paul doesn't limit it to that just alone here, by the way. No one will ever get rid of their sins or out of their sins without the final atonement that's in heaven. Paul plainly states this point here, and he makes no bones about it. Now, the word atonement, as we noted, and it's been brought out more than one time, it means at-one-ment, to be one. And at the cross, God made an at-one-ment, a reconciling with the sinner, providing him forgiveness of sin, freedom from guilt, and a full pardon. But the record of the sin is still in the sanctuary, and the root of the sin, and don't miss this, the root of the sin is still in the sinner. And the sinner must be forgiven his past and be free from the penalty of sin, but there is still the power of sin that he must overcome. And that is the very work of Jesus in the final atonement. In Patriarchs and Prophets, page 357 and 358, it says, by virtue of the atoning blood of Christ, the sins of all the truly penitent will be blotted from the books of heaven. Thus the sanctuary will be freed or cleansed from the record of sin. In type, this great work of atonement, or blotting out of sins, was represented by the service of the Day of Atonement, the cleansing of the earthly sanctuary, which was accomplished by the removal, by virtue of the blood of the sin offering, of the sins by which it had been polluted. And so while at the cross, provision was made for the forgiveness of all sins, in the final atonement, all the record of sin will be forever blotted out of the heavenly sanctuary, and that will only be possible, friends, because sin has been blotted out of our lives first and foremost.
Amen.
God's saving grace has pardoned the transgressor, saving them from the penalty of sin, and His enabling grace will empower them to be free from the draw of sin. Now, I didn't say they'd lose all the draw of sin, but they'll be free from the power of the draw of the sin. Now, the Jews considered the Day of Atonement to be the final great event in history, and was considered the judgment day of all people. And we are living in the great antitypical Day of Atonement, the time of the final end of all sin in all the lives of God's people before Jesus comes. And I believe, friends, that this should be a strong inducement to live a holy life and a pure life, for by so doing, we can fulfill the command of the first angel's message, which says to fear God and give glory to Him. Now, we mentioned a name a few times this last week, and that name was M.L. Andreessen. Remember Andreessen? He wrote a book called The Sanctuary Service, and I'd like to just read a few of the things that are in there. The matter of greatest importance in the universe is not the salvation of men. Now, this is Andreessen, okay? But catch what he's saying. The matter of greatest importance in the universe is not the salvation of men, important as that may seem. The most important thing is the clearing of God's name from the false accusations made by Satan. And we read some of those two nights ago. Remember that?
Amen.
The controversy is drawing to a close. God is preparing His people for the last great conflict. Satan is also getting ready. The issue is before us and will be decided in the lives of God's people. God is depending upon us as He did upon Job. Is His confidence well placed? And I mentioned to you a couple nights ago that it's virtually impossible for a person to vindicate themselves. Right? You know, someone sees you do something, or they think you said something or whatever, and you say, you know, I didn't mean that. I didn't say that. Well, sure, you say that now. You know, you almost have to have someone else do that for you. And the saints are going to do this for God. Because, as we noted, Satan, he has declared that God is not just, that God is not fair in His dealings with His creatures. Satan claimed that God had no right to forgive man if he himself cannot be forgiven. The final atonement, though, is the answer to Satan's charges. For if forgiveness is by divine fiat, then that's all that we need. Satan's charges would seem plausible. The plan of salvation, however, is more than just forgiveness. It's more than just a title to heaven. It is more than just freedom from the penalty of sin. We must have freedom from the power of sin, and then one day, by God's grace, He'll give us freedom from the presence of all sin. Isn't that what we need? Isn't that what you want tonight? The plan of salvation, friends, it involves a complete and total restoration of man to God, this oneness. And here is where Satan must part forever from the company of his former prey. Satan proclaims that man cannot serve God, that he's not capable of responding to God's love. Or if we do it, we only do it under selfish reasons, because we think that salvation of humanity is the great issue of the universe. Right? They're only doing this, God, because it's their skin. See? They don't do it because they love you. They don't do it because they see your goodness. They're just doing it to save their hides. God has waited until this last generation, sickened by 6,000 years of sin, to be vindicated. And today, we who are living in this last generation, we who are the weakest of the weak, will prove Satan a liar and that God is righteous and true in all of his ways. Andreasen also noted this: thus it shall be with the last generation of men living on the earth. Through them, God's final demonstration of what He can do with humanity will be given. He will take the weakest of the weak, those bearing the sins of their forefathers, and in them show the power of God. They will be subjected to every temptation, but they will not yield. They will demonstrate that it is possible to live without sin, the very demonstration for which the world's been looking and for which God has been preparing. It will become evident to all that the gospel really can save to the uttermost. God is found true in His sayings.
Amen.
God will, beloved, He will, through the final generation, prove that law, His law, and His grace are compatible. Righteousness and truth do meet and kiss at the cross. And this demonstration, friends, will not come through Enoch. It won't come through Elijah. And it's not going to come through Moses, even though they're all in the sweet glory land today. They're there by faith, by the way, don't you know? But it's going to come through people like you and me. And this demonstration is not going to be made by just a little group of us here. It's going to be made by at least 144,000. And they will make a vindication of God's character in a manner that no other generation has ever done before or since. And I tell you, I think that's a great privilege that we have. Continuing to our next slide, again from Andreasen's The Sanctuary Service on page 112. When God commands men to keep His law, it does not serve the purpose He's had in mind to have only a few men keep it. Just enough to show it can be done. It is not in line with God's character to pick outstanding men of strong purpose and superb training and demonstrate through them what He can do. It is much more in harmony with His plan to make His requirements such that even the weakest need not fail, so that none can ever say that God demands that which can be done by only a few. And think about it, friends. If it was just people like Enoch, Elijah, or Moses that could make this demonstration, we could all sit back and, you know, just relax and forget all this effort and say, you know, that was Enoch, that was Elijah, that was Moses. I don't have to come up to that standard. But God says every one of His saints can come up to that standard, because He has promised to live through Christ in each one of us. Those who are part of the 144,000, the Bible says in Revelation chapter 14, 5, that they have no guile in their mouths. In 1 Peter chapter 4, in verse 1, I believe it is, Peter says, "For as much then as Christ has suffered for us in the flesh, arm yourselves likewise with the same mind." And that's why he says in Philippians 2:5, right? "Let this mind be in you, which was also in Christ Jesus." Arm yourself with the same mind, for he that has suffered in the flesh has ceased from sin. Paul speaks of our bodies, as T was bringing out earlier today, our bodies being a temple for the Spirit of God in 1 Corinthians 6:19. And for the temple in heaven to be finally cleansed, friends, our soul temples must be first cleansed. Ellen White noted in the 1888 materials on page 127. And we read part of this to you the other night. Now Christ is in the heavenly sanctuary. And what is he doing? Making atonement for us. Cleansing the sanctuary from the sins of the people. Then we must enter by faith into the sanctuary with him. We must commence the work in the sanctuary of our souls. Now I want to just insert a little footnote here. Okay? So keep your mind where we're at right now, but this is just a little footnote. Okay? There was a man by the name of John Harvey Kellogg who wrote a book, and that book was called... Yeah, he wrote more than that book, but you would know that book, The Living Temple, right? And in that book, he was, in effect, doing away with the understanding of God and even our understanding of our sanctuary. Because he was saying the soul temple that had to be cleansed, Daniel 8:14, was all about just us. See? And it was taking away from the temple in heaven. Well, there is a temple that we have to have cleansed. That's true. But for the sanctuary in heaven, and there is a sanctuary in heaven, there's a real sanctuary, and there's a real temple that needs cleansed, we have to be cleansed too. But this isn't all that it's about. It doesn't detract from the fact that there's a sanctuary in heaven. I just want to make sure we get that footnoted, that we're not saying that there's really nothing going on in heaven today. There's something very real going off in heaven today. But this statement was made at the Minneapolis General Conference session on Sabbath, October the 20th in 1888. And Ellen White said that Jesus is in the heavenly sanctuary. She says he's there making atonement for us, cleansing the sanctuary from the sins of the people. And for this to happen, she says that we must enter into the sanctuary with Jesus by faith. And we do this by commencing the work in the sanctuary of our souls. This is the heart matter. Paul notes that the blood of Christ, who through the eternal Spirit offered himself without spot to God, is to purge your conscience from dead works to serve the living God. Since he wants to purge our conscience. And you know, the conscience is more than just the mind. The conscience is that aspect that has a realization of sin. In other words, Brother Don's walking up here, and I ask him to come up here because it's his 81st birthday today, and blessed birthday again, Brother Don. But why he comes up here, I happen to trip him. Okay? I just happened to trip him. And all of a sudden my conscience says, that was wrong. That was wrong to do, right? I have a realization of the sin. And so if God's going to purge our minds, he has to purge our conscience. And if the conscience is purged, that means that there's no realization of sin in our lives. That's what it means. And that's what he's promised. In 1893, A.T. Jones was preaching at the General Conference session. I'm not going to give you the quotes tonight because it would take too long. But you can get copies of the bulletins. They're pretty well available. Or just even the sermons of Jones's are well available. They're on the internet. They're everywhere. And in these sermons, he's talking about this process that we're talking about here tonight. And he's talking about how God wants to lead us step by step. Poca poca, right? Yes. Step by step. In this process. And he says, you know, we come into our relationship with Christ and we may not know that everything we're doing is wrong. We think everything's fine. But then we learn. We learn about things that we were doing yesterday that we didn't know were correct. And today I repent of those things. But now the Lord wants to go a little deeper. And so the next day he brings something else to my life. He's showing me something in my life that just isn't right, that needs to be changed. And he takes me a little deeper tomorrow. And this is the process, this sanctification process going on in our lives that he wants to do, and he's able to do it so that our conscience can be purged from dead works to serve the living God. Now in John chapter 6 and verse 63, Jesus said that the flesh profiteth nothing. And while I like a good shower, and I appreciate soap as much as you do, the cleansing of the flesh profiteth nothing also. It's the cleansing of the mind and the conscience that has to be obtained.
Amen.
You see? And this is what's going to happen and be done. And God's going to arrange this demonstration in such a way that this group of people called the 144,000, if they were left alive on earth for 100 years after Jesus throws down the censer and says it is done, they're still going to live without sin.
Amen.
And if He wants to leave us here 1,000,000 years, a millennium of millenniums, we'll still never sin. It doesn't matter how hard the pressure is brought upon us. We're never going to sin again. And I think God's going to take this group of people and He's going to triumphantly point to them and He's going to say, here are they that keep the commandments of God and the faith of Jesus. The text doesn't say those who profess, does it? It says, here are they that keep the commandments of God and the faith of Jesus. These are not those who simply profess to keep God's commandments, but they are a group that truly have victory over the power of sin in their lives. These people with fallen natures, with weakened wills, and of themselves totally incapable of any righteousness, will be imbued with the Spirit of Christ as they fully, totally, and knowingly surrender all themselves to God. Now, when Jesus casts the censer down, we're going to have to live in the sight of a holy God without a mediator. There's not going to be an intercessor there. And that sounds a little scary at first, doesn't it? It sounds a little scary. But it doesn't have to be scary, friends. Open your Bibles to John 14:16. John 14:16. Jesus said in that verse we all know so well, a little short verse in verse 15, if you love me, keep my commandments, and, verse 16, and I will pray the Father, and He shall give you what? Another Comforter, that He may abide with you till probation ends.
Forever.
Even though probation closes, even though Jesus no longer stands between us and the Father, friends, it doesn't mean that we don't need Jesus. It doesn't mean that we're out without Jesus. He is there to comfort us and to strengthen us and to help us. Because, friends, without Jesus, before, after, any time around probation, without Jesus, we can't do anything good. We're just evil. And we need Jesus. And He's promised to be with us through all, through the thick and the thin. There needs to be, and there must be, I would propose to you, a conscious work understood and recognized by every individual. If God were to simply wipe away the record of our sins without our understanding, without our consent or our knowledge, what would that do to help develop our character or to make us clean, pure, and holy? The last generation will be fully in harmony, friends, with heaven. In Andreessen's book, The Sanctuary Service, again, and this may be the last time we quote it, but it says, God has reserved His greatest demonstration for the last generation. This generation bears the results of accumulated sins. If any are weak, they are. If any suffer from inherited tendencies, they do. If any have excuse because of weakness of any kind, they have. If therefore these can keep the commandments, there is no excuse for anyone in any other generation not doing so also. When John Huss was called to the Council of Constance, he was given the promise of safe conduct by both the King of Bohemia and from Sigismund as well. However, we know the story. He was soon arrested after he arrived, and his life appeared to be hanging by the thinnest of the papal threads of tolerance. And Jerome had said that if Huss should fall into any peril, he himself would fly to his assistance. And he did. Jerome came to Constance, but he quickly realized he wasn't going to help John Husk, and he was going to be probably where Husk was if he didn't get out soon, and he tried to leave, and you know, they caught him, and they put him in prison, and they put him in such a terrible situation that he recanted. But then he had this problem. He had a conscience.
Amen.
Which wasn't a problem. It was a good thing that he had a conscience, and that conscience smote him, and he knew that he had sinned. And both he and Huss ended up burned to death, a martyr's death, at the stake. Both Huss and Jerome boldly challenged the popes and Satan, their master. And we might admire the courage of these two men because, as I mentioned, I think, in a talk recently, that there's few things that terrify human beings like fire. Fire is terrifying. If you were in this corner of the building, and this corner over here is in a huge flame, and the only way to get out is to go through that fire, You know, that's hard, friends. That's hard. There have been people on airplanes. Airplanes have crash-landed. They've had distress, and they've crash-landed. And now they have to get out. But the exit, to get to the exit where they have to go out, there's fire. And many people have perished in planes because they wouldn't try to go through the fire to get out. You know, they could have done it. They would have gotten burnt, sure, but they could have lived. But they were terrified of the fire, and they ended up burning up in the fire. Well, Huss and Jerome, they stood to the fire. And we admire the courage of others who have done that. But I believe the 144,000 are going to have an even greater witness. I believe that they are ready for the challenge that God is going to give them. Satan is trying them to the utmost, but they will stand face to face with death in the issuance of a death decree to worship the beast in his image, but they will not yield. They would rather die than sin. I know our time is running out, so I'm trying to gauge my time here. We are in a warfare. We're in a warfare. On December the 8th of 1941, President Roosevelt addressed Congress, and he gave that famous speech of his, a date that would live in infamy. But we are in war today, friends, and we're in just a greater war against Satan and his hosts. And God is going to raise up a people who will live the kind of life that they need to live. Paul states in Romans 3:26, to declare, I say at this time, his righteousness, that he might be just and the justifier of him that believeth in Jesus. Not only will God perfect his people, but he's going to be shown to be just in doing it. He will be shown to be just as he justifies us in all we do. And this ministry of Jesus in the heavenly sanctuary, it's going to close. We know that it's going to close. And there's going to be people who are just, and they will continue to be just for eternity. There's going to be people who are wicked, and they're going to continue to be wicked for eternity. You can read it in Revelation chapter 22, verses 11 and 12. But this declaration of Jesus, please get this, is important, right? So let's not go to sleep. Let's get this one. This declaration of Jesus is not an arbitrary decree. It's not just some time that's been set, regardless of what happens in man's life. It is simply an acknowledgement that a great polarization has finally occurred and finished. The wicked have so rejected the Spirit of God that they will be forever wicked. The righteous have been sealed with the seal of God, and they will be righteous forever, regardless of the storm, regardless of the tempest or the temptation. They will never, ever sin again. And so the services of the sanctuary will finish. Because it's out of business. I think someone brought that up the other day. It's out of business. And we here, we have a part to play in how this timing plays out. If you would turn with me to 2 Peter chapter 3 and verse 12. Now this was a text that our early Adventist pioneers loved and they used. And we don't hear it ever spoken of anymore. You know that? You don't hear this text preached anymore. 2 Peter 3:12, looking for and hastening unto the coming of the day of God, wherein the heavens being on fire shall be dissolved and the elements shall melt with fervent heat. Did you catch the first part of this text? What does that mean? What did that mean to our Adventist pioneers?
Everything.
It means that what we do has an effect upon the timing of the second coming of Jesus. And the fact is that on more than one occasion, God was ready and willing and desirous to take the Advent people into the Promised Land. And because of rebellion and stubbornness, he couldn't do it. Now, we are living in time. We were passing out the literatures today. And I was talking with a man. He says, what do you think about today? And I said, I think it's a pretty bad day to live. He says, we are living in a day of Sodom and Gomorrah. And I said, yes, we are, sir. And I said, if God doesn't do something soon, he's going to have to apologize to Sodom and Gomorrah for burning them up. God cannot wait on us much longer, friends. There's going to be a group of people that are going to get it. They're going to see it, right? They're going to see it. And God's going to say, it's done. And I want to be a part of that final generation. Now, Maybe I should touch on a point here. Does this final generation have a different standard of salvation than others?
No.
Well, you know, according to Ephesians chapter 2, verse 8, we're all saved by grace through faith, aren't we? Isn't that what the Bible says?
Mm-hmm.
But I want you to consider something else now for a minute. Let's turn to Genesis 26. I want you to notice what it says in verse 5. It says, because that Abraham obeyed my voice, kept my charge, my commandments, my statutes, and my laws. Abraham obeyed God. Now, this is written after Abraham made some flubs. Abraham had some lacks of faith in his life, didn't he, at times? But now Abraham's went through the test that's recorded four chapters earlier, and he's proven to be the kind of man that God says is my friend. In John chapter 8 and verse 56, Jesus said, your father Abraham rejoiced to see my day, and he saw it and was glad. Abraham saw that day, friends. I believe that Abraham was saved by grace through faith, don't you?
Amen.
But he was saved before Jesus died on the cross. See? He found this relationship with Jesus before he died. Enoch, Elijah, and Moses, I've mentioned those three men at least twice prior to this point in our talk tonight. And those three men are all have something in common. What is that they have in common? They're in heaven today. And how many of them lived after the cross?
None.
You mean they went to heaven before the cross, before the blood was shed? Yes, they could go by faith, didn't they? And I'd like to propose to you, I think that those very kind of men, like Abraham, experienced a similar experience by faith of the final atonement that we have a privilege to do. But we are going to give a demonstration that they didn't give. They had the ability and they came to that position, I believe, why they had a mediator still mediating between them and the Father. But we will not. We will not. And we need to be prepared for that. But in 1 John chapter 4 and verse 4, it says, greater is he that is in you than he that is in the world. And we read the promise from John chapter 14, verse 16 earlier. Christ has promised through his Spirit to abide with us for how long?
Forever.
I believe that, don't you? Now, forgiveness. Forgiveness is not an evolutionary process. Right?
Right.
In other words, God doesn't say, well, if you will repent, Alan, and if you will be on probation for a while, I'll forgive you. But the fact is that the work of sanctification is the work of a lifetime. And we all need it. Whatever life God has given us, and I'm just encouraged because sometimes we know of people or we experience them, maybe in our family, someone who's cut down early. And we thought that person was a really good Christian. That person really loved the Lord. Why was the Lord allowing him to get cut down? All I know is this, that the Lord gave him that man his lifetime, or that woman her lifetime, enough to finish out whatever work needed to be done for them. I may live to be 100 if the Lord doesn't come within a certain amount of time, because I need that much time. I'm probably stiff-necked and rebellious and stubborn, and you know, I haven't seen it all my life either, like I want to. But by God's grace, He's helping me. The prophet Isaiah, in Isaiah chapter 9, verse 6, he said, unto us a child is born, unto us a son is given, and the government shall be upon his shoulders. Isaiah 9, 6. No earthly government is spoken of here. It is the stability of God's government, which rules over the entire universe, that the Father has entrusted to Jesus Christ. And if, by sinning, Jesus had failed in his plan to redeem man, the whole government of God would have failed. And in the last days, God's going to allow him to live in the lives of his people completely. And their lives will uphold and sustain at that time the government of God. Ellen White, in the book Maranatha, it says, there must be a purifying of the soul here upon earth in harmony with Christ's cleansing of the sanctuary in heaven. And that's what I want. I want that in my life. As I allow him to live, I thought that Brother Esty really eloquently presented some of this to us this morning. Because this is what is having Christ living in us. And as we day by day learn to submit more and more and more of our lives. Because today I think I'm surrendering all. We sang that song earlier, I surrender all. But tomorrow God shows me there's a part of my life that isn't totally surrendered. And I have to give that to him tomorrow. And then I'm surrendering all, but it's not all because there's something else I've missed, and so he's going to show me more tomorrow. And so I can work with him in purifying the soul while the temple in heaven is being purified. In the Review on Hell of March 9, 1905, we were told that we should strive with all of our power that God has given us to be among the 144,000. I believe that, don't you? Isn't that your desire tonight? Now Jesus says, sanctify them through thy
truth.
Thy word is truth. We're not going to get sanctified without the truth, friends. Error can't sanctify us. Error is never harmless. We need the truth, and we need the truth that God gave to us as a people. You know the statement in Life Sketches, page 196. We have nothing to fear for the future, except as we shall forget the way the Lord has led us and His teaching in our past history. And we like to quote that, those of us in this Godhead movement, or whatever you want to call it, the Truth About God movement, I just say it's Christianity. This is really what Christianity is. And we like to talk about the fact that we know God, and we know the same God our pioneers knew. But I'd like to say that tonight, and especially for this week, and for everything that we take in our lives after we leave here this week, that we must not forget the teachings of the sanctuary and the final atonement that God has given us as a people. But yet we have a responsibility to take that truth that God has given us and to elevate it to a plane higher than it has ever hitherto been given us. And I've heard some of that done this week, and I want to hear more of it done, don't you? And I want to see it in my life lived out. And my appeal is that I wanted to see it lived out in your life. And if you're willing to really surrender all that you have today, and you're willing to say, Lord, show me tomorrow more, He'll show you more. I promise you, He will show you more. He shows it to me, and He'll show it to you. And then we can all be a part of that great multitude that's going to stand on the sea of glass, having the hearts of God, singing the song of Moses and the Lamb. And I want to do that with you, don't you? Sister Sandy has a song she's going to sing at this time for us.
Soon we'll come to the end of life's journey, and perhaps we'll never meet anymore. Till we gather in heaven's bright city, far away on that beautiful shore. If we never meet again this side of heaven, as we struggle through this world and its strife, there's another meeting place somewhere in heaven, by the beautiful river of life, where the charming roses bloom forever, and separations come no more. If we never meet again this side of heaven, I will meet you on that beautiful shore.